It's wonderful to be back in Mississippi. I've got some very fond memories of traveling around the state and visiting dozens of communities. And so it was great to get a chance to talk to several thousand of the people about some of the great stories around Mississippi and people that are making a difference in the state.
And some of those stories, can you share some of those with us?
Sure. For example, I use around the whole country when I'm giving these talks, I use the example of George McLean in Tupelo, Mississippi, and what he did to transform that community from one of the poorest communities in the entire state into the second wealthiest on a per capita basis, and why it was a community that Toyota decided to go to when you looked at it compared to all the other places in the country that they could go to. Another example is Columbus, Mississippi, where Joe Higgins and Allegra Brigham have done a wonderful job on developing that community. Oxford, Mississippi is another example of a community that, as I've traveled around and toured over 1,000 communities, that is the one that stands out in my mind as the best downtown that I have seen out of those 1,000-plus communities around the state. Ruleville, Mississippi, where Billy Marlowe stepped into a hospital that was failing, turned it around, and today has turned a money-losing operation into one that is making money, but more importantly, is helping to transform that entire region. Has grown from 180 to over 500 employees, and I could go on and on with other examples around the state of Mississippi.
What does it take? What do business leaders need to know about these stories, the good parts and then even the bad parts? What do communities in Mississippi need and what do they not need as far as economic development?
Well, I think the key is to know that it is possible and that it only takes one or two or a real handful of people to turn a community around. And it also is not rocket science. And there's a lot of examples that you can copy from around the country so you don't have to reinvent the wheel. You've just got to keep at it. It takes a lot of persistence, perseverance, and you've got to have a thick skin to be able to withstand the people in the community that are generally negative, the curmudgeons in the community, if you will, that don't want things to change. But you've got to change if you want a place where your kids and your grandkids are going to be able to come back to live and to work.
Thinking, you also mentioned China and just the 421 policy I thought was interesting, and then how that affects manufacturing. What can you say about that?
Yeah, the 421 policy was the one-child policy in China. And basically what you have is, because of that, you have four grandparents that had two children that have one child. And so the positive of that is that you've got six people that are supporting one child in their development. The downside of it is that when that one child gets older, is that suddenly that one child is supporting six people, and it becomes quite a burden in the long term. And so it's a demographic catastrophe for China, and is one of the reasons that you're seeing some turmoil occurring in that country, wages rising dramatically, and why the Boston Consulting Group estimated that by 2020 that it would be as inexpensive to produce in the U.S. as in China, and that 3 million jobs would move back in the manufacturing sector from China back to the U.S.
Do people know about this, the fact that the manufacturing could come back in the United States?
No, it's a secret. It's just amazing. And, you know, as I've given up and given talks, is that too many people have heard on the TV, oh, we've lost all of our manufacturing jobs and they're all going to China. And one of the statistics that I quote, and then I've got a graph on it, that unfortunately there was a mix-up in the it didn't get shown, but it shows that the United States produces more than China does, than Japan, and then of the next eight countries combined, countries like Germany and the United Kingdom and Brazil and Russia, Italy and Canada and some others, and that we today produce about 22% of the world's manufactured goods, even though we only have 3% of the world's population.